is NDTV and you are watching NDTV Prime.
Thanks so much for tuning into the Property Show North Edition. Let's begin with some of the headline stories, and we've got quite a few important ones today. All buyers will be party to a case filed against a builder and will also get relief in every case, rules NCDRC in a landmark judgment, which actually makes class action possible and could make things very hard for developers. We will decode this judgment on the show today. Also, affordable homes in Greater Noida will be culled out in a budget of 25 to 35 lakh. Promising residential hotspots of Gurgaon for homes in 90 lakh rupees. Best budget properties around the central business districts of Lucknow. Lucknow has been coming up time and again on the show. In fact, almost every week we're getting a question for Lucknow. And buy your dream home this Diwali as housebolo.com. And JLL bring you exclusive Diwali deals from India's leading developers. That's on the show today. Our most important discussion and top story: in a move that could potentially put huge financial burden on the already cash-strapped developer, a three-member bench of the National Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission, which is NCDRC, has ruled that all buyers of a housing project will be made party to any case filed against the real estate developer by another buyer. So this is basically allowing for class action. A ruling that may dramatically increase the scale of lawsuits filed against errant builders while benefiting thousands of homebuyers across the country. But really, will that happen? Gitambar Anand, President CREDAI, National and CMD ATS Infrastructure, and Sahil Sethi, Senior Associate, Sai Krishna and Associates, with me here on this discussion. Sahil, from a legal aspect or legal point of view, it seems like it's a big victory. You know, there are a lot of buyers who are unable to approach courts, whether it's a consumer court or a national court, and fight on their behalf. So it now seems that any five buyers who have the wherewithal and the time can file a case, and everybody else will benefit. But is that how it will pan out?
Legally, yes. But practically, we'll have to see. Mm-hmm. See, one apprehension definitely is that while this is legally possible now, for a group of buyers, a small group of buyers, to be approaching the NCDRC, claiming themselves to be the representatives. And if the NCDRC feels that they have approached the NCDRC in a bona fide fashion and their intention is all clear, may give them the permission to represent the entire buyer community of that particular project. So while this is good news for those who do not have the means to approach the commission themselves, the practical aspects of it is something that we will have to look into, of how a decree of that magnitude will be enforceable. So what used to happen right now is that, and we've already been seeing, there have been tremendous decrees that have been passed by the National Commission, which are then taken to the Supreme Court, with the result not coming to the buyers. Now, with the scale, let's say, being multiplied by thousands, mm-hmm. of how will these decrees get executed, who will pay that kind of compensation, whether the builders have that kind of money or not, are all questions that will have to be seen.
Before I go to Mr. Anand, here's another question to you. So NCDRC, give us some examples of cases which NCDRC has ruled in the favor of the buyer and have gone to Supreme Court and the judgment has really not benefited the buyer. So Unitech is one.
Unitech, okay. Vista's judgment is one. See, in all the cases, it won't be right to say the builder moving to the Supreme Court has been completely against the buyers. The Supreme Court, I believe, is trying to find a buyer media. Okay. Is trying to secure possession of apartments for the buyers first. And an example, I think, which is a positive example we can take, is Calypso Court buyers who got compensation from the NCDRC.
Right.
While the Supreme Court stayed the judgment, the Supreme Court also ensured that there is a certain amount of money that the developer in that case puts it in the Supreme Court as a security. Mm-hmm. So that tomorrow, if the buyers were to succeed, that money could be given to the buyers. So I think the Supreme Court is trying to play the balancing act now, trying to salvage the situation that has been created.
All right, fair enough. So NCDRC for the buyer, but Supreme Court tries to bring in a more, and that's supposed to be the apex court of the country and is meant to do the fairest of all fair jobs. Gitamber Anand, very quickly, I mean, I know that when the judgment came, you were extremely upset and you said this is really going to, you know, be misused by buyers and this is not good for the industry. It's almost like sounding a death knell. Is it that serious? I mean, why is the concern so much? To me, it seems that really there are so many buyers stuck in maybe just five developers where maximum stress lies. But those people do need some redemption.
So, two things, Manisha. First thing is, you know, you can't paint all developers with the same brush. If there are five developers who have not delivered, and you can't say that 95% of the developers haven't delivered. They delivered. People are living in those complex, such complexes happily. Let me put things in perspective. Now, there are two kinds of buyers. One is the end user, and one is the investor. And there are two kinds of situation. One is where there's a delay in possession, where a penalty is to be paid, and that's what the developer and the buyer agreement says, and of course it is enforceable. If there's a delay, penalty has to be paid. There are no twos about it. Now, there are two kinds of buyers, like I said earlier. One is the investor who puts in his money to make profit. You know, when the project is complete, they make profit. And one puts in his money because he's going to live there with his family and he's an end user.
Right.
In the former case, what happens is now the market in the last 3-4 years hasn't really done well. Now, I'm not talking of projects where possession hasn't been given. I'm talking of projects where possession is being offered after getting OCs and completion certificates.
Fair enough.
So now possession is offered, but this investor who had invested at, let's say, 5,000 rupees a square foot, price X, and now at possession, the price is still, it's not appreciated at all. So he's really not too keen to take possession. And he would rather wait for a while so that maybe, you know, he does see some upside because there's no other way to exit the investment. And I've experienced it. I'm talking from first-hand experience. What such people do, and in every project, there is a handful of such people. What they do is they, when you offer possession to them, they refuse possession on the most frivolous grounds. You know, saying, you know, I won't take this because this is not right. Maybe in my apartment, that is not right. Now, in such cases, when they go to the NCDRC,
right,
and they get relief, and this is a class action suit,
okay,
it spells very, very...
Okay, Mr. Anand, I think I've got your point.
It's a very negative,
I've got your point. I think what you're trying to make, the point that you're trying to make is that the buyers themselves are probably willing to wait a little bit to get their apartments. Investors are more impatient. And even when they want to get a product, they would like to, if they're not making money, try and make some money out of the builder. Sahil, are you really that concerned? I mean, most of the cases I have seen going in front of NCDRC are the ones where there is actually a lot of distress. Projects haven't been delivered in a very, very long time, and timelines have run out. Developers seem to have no money to honor any commitment to the buyer.
I completely agree with you. I think what Mr. Anand is saying might be, I'm not saying that's completely false. That might have happened in certain instances, but I would say 90% of the cases, it's only when a concerned person feels that all the talks, all the meetings, all the negotiations have not borne any fruit, mm-hmm, is when the concerned person approaches the NCDRC. And see, the idea here is not for an investor to go ahead and say, I will trouble the builder. The idea here is for a group of people to get together, and the NCDRC saying, we don't need any registration formalities. We don't want you to become a registered society if you don't want to be one. Mm-hmm. And you can directly come to us. And in the process, to avoid multiplicity of proceedings, which is the basic purpose of this section.
To make it easier.
Easier, because what has been happening as mm-hmm, more and more, as the news of more and more judgments in favor of buyers keeps on reaching the ears of more and more buyers, there are multiplicity of proceedings that happens before the NCDRC. And I think a lot of judicial time goes in these matters. And that is why I think the NCDRC thought that this is the right opportune time when,
okay,
a judgment like this comes, so that all these multiple proceedings which have this common genesis, either buyers, see, the common genesis in all these complaints would either be that these agreements are unfair or there has been a delay in giving possession. So they have a common thread in them. So if,
okay,
the thread is common, why not dispose them off in one fashion?
All right.
And to maintain unanimity and also to save time and resources and money for everybody.
All right. So that's the judicial part of it. And I think courts are trying to lessen the burden and make it more equitable in terms of a solution. Why is it that if 10 buyers go, let's just take JP as a case here or a Unitech, because, you know, those are distressed builders. And I think 50% of the trauma in the country is between these two groups. You know, why would just 10 guys get some money out of a delayed project and the rest won't? Mr. Anand, come in here. I think once we have established that, yes, for frivolous matters, this is pretty much not the way to go. But for serious matters, probably the judiciary wants to make it easier for themselves and for the buyers. Tell me, in the other side of the story, I mean, if there is a class action, where will the builder even pay, let's say, 500,000 crores, which might become his liability?
So actually, you see, when there's an inordinate delay, like in the few names you've mentioned, you can't defend the indefensible. It's as clear as that. But let's go by the wisdom of the Supreme Court. So the Supreme Court understands that there are not enough cash flows for the developer to refund money. So in all the three cases which have actually gone to the Supreme Court, in its wisdom, the court has, like Sahil said, they have impressed on possession. So they say, okay, there is a penalty which you have to pay, but let's work together towards completing the project and giving these people possession. So if that is the attitude, it's a very balanced attitude, it's the correct attitude. But if some court goes on to say, okay, now you refund 5,000 buyers of yours, now the developer, let's admit the fact that, okay, there has been mismanagement, but he has spent money on doing whatever construction he has done. Refunding money to these people is impossible. You know, the developer will say, I just don't have the money, like we did see in two or three cases in the Supreme Court. So I would say that as an industry body, we do not expect the Supreme Court to take such a knee-jerk reaction and give a judgment favoring refund. And having seen what has happened in the past 3-4 judgments, we really appreciate the kind of judgments that have been given, wherein possession has been the primary focus and there has been some money asked to be deposited as a guarantee to give that possession. So end of the day, the projects are to be completed, money will be not refunded, but it will be spent towards construction. Right. So that is the right attitude for these few developers where possession has been inordinately delayed.
All right. Sahil, very quickly decode for us the positives of this judgment and the not so positive of that judgment, and we'll conclude with that.
The positives of the judgment is that not everybody needs to go to that judicial process. If a person is unable to do it because of health, because of age, because of means, that person does not necessarily have to go through that entire judicial process, which can anywhere between a year and a half in this country, to the least. And so that's the biggest positive, I believe, of this judgment, and also saving the judicial time, which is also very important, I think. The negative would be, I would say, the impact from a execution point of view. It is good to have a decree in your hand which says pay 5,000 crores, but whether anybody has that kind of money is not something to be seen. So I would say that. And yes, a slight discomfort from the fact that the consumer forum, the object and purpose of it is to benefit the consumers in the true sense of the word. The definition may differ from person to person, but definitely a person who, let's say, has 50 apartments in a project for purely investment purposes would not be a consumer.
So you agree with Gitambar on that point? Not meant for investors to pay for the blood and try and make money. Okay.
But let me just complete. I think where if the consumer forum, as it has shown in its judgment in the past, it's completely driven to benefit the buyers. I'm sure they'll find in their right wisdom their legal experts, their eminent jurists. I'm sure they'll find a solution to this problem as well.
And I think the judges can see through investors and a bunch of investors trying to make money vis-a-vis actually end buyers. Gitambar Anand and Sahil Sethi, thank you very much, gentlemen. This was an important, notice or let's say order which had to be decoded for all our buyers. Pleasure to have you with us, gentlemen. All right, we're going to now take questions which have been waiting by. Noida, Greater Noida and Gurgaon are some of the markets of North India which will be covered. Akash Bansal, Business Head North and Director of Lysis Forest joins me. Akash, thanks very much for being here. All right, Amit Verma on the phone line with us. Amit, hi, go ahead with your question.
Yeah, hi, this is Amit. Actually, my question is that I'm looking for investment come residential property in Noida Extension. Mm-hmm. And I have given to, I have two options. One is Magun Mantra, and the other one is Aznara Sports City.
All right.
So I just want to know, because in Magun Mantra, I have checked that there is no sports amenities. Like, we don't have any sports amenities in Magun Mantra. So can I go for Aznara Sports City in that case?
All right. Okay, fair enough. I think Mahagun, Mantra 1, Ajnara Sports City, both in Noida Extension, both possession will be by 2017. His thing is, one doesn't have a sports city. Sporting facilities are becoming more and more important, Akash. People do want their children to be very active and themselves as well. I mean, there are people who are playing till 70, 80 years of age. So what do you think?
Absolutely. Because, you know, in present scenarios, you know, amenities are the key.
So my question is, what you need to evaluate is whether Ajnara is just named as a sports city or does it have those many sporting facilities more than Magun?
No, Ajnara, in any case, this is a big township. This is an integrated township of around, I believe, 70 to 75 acres. So it has a good number of amenities, good open areas for the end users, for the buyers. So before getting into the particular project, let us explore the micro market. You know, this micro market is a affordable category micro market, and this is a good micro market for the end user to actually invest into this particular area, and this is very well connected with the NH24, Ghaziabad, Noida, Greater Noida. So if we conclude the number of projects and, you know, micro market trends, so there are total 101 projects in this micro market with a total supply of around 95,000 units, with a unsold supply of around 44 to 45,000 units in this micro market. And the average price that has been ranging in this micro market is around 3,500, with an annualized return of around 0.7% per annum in last 3 years. Now, both these projects, Mahagun Mantra and Ajnara Sports City, these are the good projects to. But you know, however, the possession is likely to be in 2017. Mahagun Mantra is in sector 10 of Greater Noida West, which is a Noida Extension, and it's been quoted at around 3,500 with a total inventory of 400 units. So it has a unit size of 1,025 and 1,200 square feet for a 2 BHK that can very well fit into your budget. So this is a 9-acre township. It does not have a, you know, so much of a luxurious sports facilities. It has a clubhouse, it has a multi-purpose court, swimming pool, and the normal sports facility it does have. When we talk about the other project, Ajnara, this Ajnara Khelgaon, this is at around 2,900, owing to the large size, large inventory in this particular project. So total units in this project is around 1,000. So you can get a 2 BHK in the range of 895 to 1195. And this is a 67 or a 70 acres township. So you can get a good number of facilities in this particular project. So, but both these projects are going to be delivered in 2017. But if you're looking at a closer, you know, possession, which we request you to look into and explore, is going to be delivered by end of 2016 is Habitech Panch Tattwa, which is by Habitech Infrastructure Limited. So this is at around 3,460, and you can get a studio apartment, you can get a 2 BHK, 3 BHK or 4 BHK, depending upon your budget. So you can invest into any of these
opportunities. All right, so great options in 25 to 35 lakhs. Both the projects that you've shortlisted, sir, have got a go-ahead, Amit. And there's one more, which is Habitech Panch Tattwa, which has got added by the Lysis Forest data, saying that there's earlier possession in this project. So you can also go for this. Subhash Sood on the phone line with us. Subhash, hi. Thank you very much for joining us here on The Property Show. How can we help you?
Yeah, hi, ma'am. Please advise me, like, a good and safe property around my preference, Golf Course, and my bedroom, the local property preference, like 2 by 3 BHK. Mm-hmm. And my budget is like 90 lakhs. So kindly suggest me, like, and this is in Gurgaon.
All right, so Gurgaon, now that's a very, very large area. Now we can take you right up to Sona Road, we can also take you to Golf Course Extension, and we can take you to New Gurgaon in that budget. All three will fit in. So where are you going to take him,
so
and why?
His preference is towards the Golf Course, so I think Golf Course Extension he's looking at.
Then Golf Course Extension,
right.
Absolutely.
But Golf Course Extension is a market which is, you know, which we can term it as a partly developed and partly developing. So it has a combination of both developed projects and the developing projects. But however, I am concerned that, you know, you won't get a 3 BHK or above in the price range of around 90-95 lakhs. So you will have to, and one more concern is there is very limited inventory of 2 BHK in this micro market. And you know, when we come down to the projects, you know, there are limited around 15 projects in this micro market with around total inventory of around 6500 units with the inventory overhang of 47 months. So weighted average price in this micro market is ranging somewhere around 11,000 to 12,000 rupees a square feet. And when we get down to the number of projects which we can suggest, you know, there is very limited inventory of 2 BHK. So REO Uptown you can look at, which has a 2 BHK range is around 1200 to 1250 square feet. So it's you will get into the resale market because this is a ready project. Builder does not have that kind of inventory with him. So you will get it in the price range of 7500 to 8000 rupees a square feet. Second project that you can look at is Pioneer Park. This is also a ready to move in property. Builder has started giving possession by starting from mid-2016. So price here would range between 7,800 to 8,200. This is a 75 acres integrated development you can look at. Thirdly, the project which is going to be in possession by 2017 is M3M1T Regiment. So this is in sector 67. So price here is around 9,250, and this is a 17 acres township. All these projects have a good amenities facilities, so you can look at any of these projects.
All right, so REO Uptown, Pioneer Park and M3M, One Key Residence are some of the three projects which you can look in. Well, we'll be back with lot more properties. Lucknow is on our radar, and if you're eyeing property overseas, what are the top destinations that you can look at? Stay tuned.